Hey, Rawhide fans, I'm Jill Guerin, and I'm lucky enough to be joined by the entire coaching staff of the 2019 California League Champions. We have manager Sean Roof, hitting coach Travis Benker, pitching coach Shane Luce, and of course, coach Nick Evans. Thanks for joining me, guys.
Hey, thanks for having us.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah. So, first of all, where is everyone during the stay-at-home order? Are you guys good? How's your families doing?
I'll start it off. I'm here in Erie, Pennsylvania. It's about 37 degrees right now with snow flurries, so we're doing well. But first off, before the other guys get on, I just want to say hi to all the Rawhide fans. Know that we miss you guys and we're praying for you, but we also want to pray for and let all the people know that we're thinking of all the healthcare people out there who are fighting this disease head on, and all the essential workers that are helping our keep our restaurants and stores afloat so we can have food and everything like that. So know we're behind you. We're praying for you 100%, and know you guys will get us out of this.
Travis?
So I'm in Verado, Arizona, Buckeye, Arizona. It's 80. It's been 80. It's been sunny. Sunshine every day, but the pools are closed, so it's been kind of challenging there, but we're hanging in there. Everybody's healthy with us. We are really looking forward to playing this year, but it's just when we're really really miss the people in Visalia right now, but we're good. And again, like Rufy said, we're praying, and our thoughts and prayers go out to everybody that's out there, and hopefully Visalia's healthy as well.
Yeah. Shane, how about you?
I'm in Sylvania, Ohio. It kind of feels like an off season for us, like an extended off season. Not a whole lot's changed, which we're extremely blessed to kind of be normal right now. The kids are jumping on the trampoline. We're throwing the baseball around. We're just having a good time with the family, kind of enjoying an extended off season, but we are definitely, everybody's looking forward to getting back.
And Nick, how about you? Where are you at?
I'm also in Phoenix. We've actually been enjoying some quality time with the kids that we don't normally get this time of year. So we're fortunate to have good weather and, desert to ride our bikes in and hang out. So we've been having a good time under the circumstances.
I'm glad you guys are all doing well and families are safe and everything. So let's get into some of the more fun questions. My first question is actually for Travis. So, you were at the Rawhide in 2018. You saw Rancho win it and everything. So how did that affect this championship for you? Did it make it a little bit sweeter almost?
Yeah, so we get beat by Rancho, and we're hoping that that's who we would have played in the finals, but we ended up beating them and them getting out. But either way, it was awesome. We got so close that year, and just a little tiny things that kept us out of winning that thing. It just wasn't meant to be. And then getting a chance to go back in there, beat up San Jose, and then beat on Lake Elsinore, who had a fantastic team. These guys were studs, and our guys just they just did the little things, and it was amazing, man. I mean, I still think about it. It's really cool, man. These guys really, really, really executed, and they really deserved it. They worked really hard. That was one thing, man. In the heat, everything, day in and day out. And the one thing that they did do is you could just see as the team went, like, we would lose some guys to AA or like an injury here, but like the next guy just came in and stepped up. And that was the coolest thing to see is how the team just meshed together. They loved each other. And it was really cool to see them come out victorious at the end there.
Yeah. I talked to Brecken a few weeks ago, and he said the word that he used was selfless for the team. He thought that it was one of the selfless teams that he's been on. And he thinks that was one of big push to end the championship. Another question actually relating to 2018, because I never got to actually witness these, but your Denker views, it started in 2018. How did that come about, and how did you transition it into 2019?
Yeah, so the idea came from Joe Mather, the manager before. So for me, speaking to Joe, Matt Mather had an idea. I backed it up because I wanted our players, and we agreed upon having our players get used to talking to media and get used to talking to people. And and finding out kind of like trying to trick them and just ask them questions like, you know, seeing if they would basically stumble upon their words kind of like I am right now or whatever. But like, but it's just it was an opportunity to practice in between their team and then, you know, be held accountable from their teammates. And we try to put them and ask them questions that were funny. So it was like more to like get to know each other and then, you know, try to trick them. And they did really good. And some of them didn't do so good, but, you know, but it's all about learning. It's all about growing. And so that's kind of how it came about. And then they just continue to progress after that. And the next thing you know, it was not necessarily a roasting session, but we'd find dirt on them. Like I'd ask the teammates, like if they'd done anything. So it almost came more of like a, you know, not a hazing, but it was more of like a, to get each other, you know, more used to each other. And the more, I feel like the more we know each other, the more we love each other, the more we have each other's back. So a lot of times people just don't know who's next to them in the trenches. And so the more we can understand where these guys are coming from as teammates, like the better we're going to have them on the field in the clubhouse, and we're going to have each other's backs. And I think that created another part of what Joe did. And also what Rufy does is create that environment. So I think it was I definitely think is a positive thing.
Yeah, I actually got to see Wyatt, the Bat Boys interview. Sean sent it to me. So that was really cool. Does anyone have a favorite Denker view that they got to witness?
I thought Wyatt's was pretty good. Luis Misabes was awesome too, because he's got a twin brother. So, you know, one thing is funny that Denker didn't put on, but like, let's say a kid is from Venezuela, he's always like, what was it like to grow up in the Dominican Republic? You know, he'd always flub that around and they get all hurt about it and everything like that. So, it was a lot of fun. But just to see Denker's character come out, because he keeps such a straight face all the time. And he had me rolling every single time.
Awesome. Anyone else before I move on? So this question is now for Nick. You're the only one who's not going to be returning for the 2020 season. You're going to be manager in the Arizona League. So what parts of your coaching style in Visalia and what you learned in Visalia do you think you'll bring as a manager in Arizona?
Well, I think as a staff, we did a pretty good job of creating an environment where everybody was comfortable expressing their opinions to each other. Whether they were good or bad. And I wasn't expecting that. And I thought that was an extremely valuable thing where, I mean, luckily we were all young, all the staff was young, which is kind of a unique situation in the minor leagues to have four coaches so young. But I think it was a good environment for the staff as far as being able to trust each other and bounce ideas without worrying about offending somebody. So I think that's something I would definitely like to bring, you know, to the AZL for our staff, which I think we'll be able to do.
And what are you looking forward to most in your first year as managing?
Well, that's a good question. I've never done this before, so you don't really know what to expect going into a job that you've never done. So I think it's going to be a good learning experience for me, and you know, I'm looking forward. I think it'll be fun.
Cool. And so moving on to Shane now. I've interviewed quite a few players so far. A lot of pitchers actually just kind of, they have the time to do it for whatever reason. And they've said that they've talked to you a lot about kind of how to be throwing right now in this weird off season that they're going through. What are you telling them to do right now?
Well, it's unique to the individual. And luckily, you know, I got to build relationships enough to kind of give them some blanket advice, but yet make it somewhat personalized to who they are as people. So in general, you know, we're just kind of telling them to treat it like an off season leading into a season, you know, and you kind of throw a little bit, you know, a couple heavy days, a couple light days, you know, you kind of move your intensity around, you take some days off, you get off the mound if you want to, you know, it's just basically treat it as you're heading into a season in late December, early January. So, you know, you might throw off the mound, you might not. You might be playing a lot of long toss, you might not. You're not really crushing weights to get strong. You're more maintaining heading into a season. So that's kind of where we are. I do talk to the guys a lot. I think it's important. We as a group think it's important to continually reach out and let them know we're thinking about them. And you know, a lot of times there's questions that they're not comfortable asking. But if, you know, you reach out a lot and you push the right buttons, then you can put them at ease with some of your answers. So we're trying to do that as a group. And we, you know, it's working. A lot of guys are finding out, you know, getting into rhythm now to keep themselves moving. So when we do get the opportunity to play again, they're ready to go.
So this is mainly for Shane, but anyone else can hop in too, because I'm sure you guys kind of have the same thing. But Shane, like how you said in the beginning of your answer, it's unique to every player. And just from what I saw in the bullpen and everything, when I was there before games, you were very big on kind of helping the player figure out what was best for them. How do you do that as a coach when you had your own routine and you might think that something might work better for them, but you want them to kind of make that decision in the end?
A lot of it is, you know, is trying to build those relationships, because the more a guy opens up to you, the more you can, you know, talk about it, things that aren't baseball, the more it'll help you relate to them on the field or help you come up with things for that specific player. And that's the way I was coached. You know, when I had a coach ask me how my family was, and then I would, like, they really mean that. It's not just a blanket question that they don't really want to get in the conversation, but then I could feel that as a player. And then, by the way, we're also being taught to coach from our mentors and our leaders in our organization. It's a relationship-based thing. So when I take the time to get to know somebody or go out to a cup of coffee with somebody or just, you know, truly listen to what they have to say, it allows me to find ways to reach them a little different, because how you deal with a, you know, 25-year-old married man that has a kid is different than a 19-year-old, you know, that still lives at home with his parents. How you deal with somebody who comes from an inner city is different than a farm boy from Missouri, you know. And so getting to know them on a personal level, it helps a ton. And I know that this goes way beyond pitching, but on how we deal with them and how we can relate to them, things we come up with, maybe we reach into our past. You know, I played with a farm boy from Missouri, and this is how he did things. So, you know, you don't necessarily know the player, let the player know that, but you just kind of choose and pick things to tell certain guys. And you know, we are all still new to coaching, you know, so how we go about it, we're going to screw it up sometimes, and we just keep pulling from those experiences and taking them into the next guy and the next guy and the next guy.
Right. Anyone else have anything to add on that? Cool. All right, let's move on to Rufy. So Sean, you've had a pretty insane, I mean, all of you guys did, with winning the first half. So first minor league team to clinch a playoff spot, and then eight players were all-stars, mid-season all-stars, and then second half champs, and then an insane playoff run. Plus you were named 2019 Manager of the Year. Can you kind of give a recap of what this year was for you?
Oh, I mean, just to start off, it was a blast. You know, just very, very lucky to work with such a great coaching staff, with Shane, Travis, Nick, Luis Severio was part of it. The support staff with Derek Tarkonish, Derek Somerville, Mike Powell, and then Noah and Orlando in the clubhouse. And those guys were great. And so they really took over a lot of things and made my job easier, where I could just kind of let them do let them have freedom and do their things. These guys are awesome. They're going to do great things in this game. So it's really fun to see. And I think when the season started, when we left Arizona, we knew we were going to have a really good pitching and defense. And we knew that our offense was going to be very versatile and have some speed and be able to do some things with a small game, and then obviously hit the ball to the ballpark at times, things like that. But like you said, I mean, it's really hard to put into words. I mean, we had so many players that came up throughout the year. A lot of guys got ready to go to the next level, which at the end of the day, the championship, I think that was everybody's goal. Everybody that comes in to start a season is to win a championship. And it was really cool that our guys were able to do that. But it was really cool to see so many guys come up or to start the year with us, be able to go to Double A, help those guys win a championship in Jackson. guys that came up from extended, Kane County. Those guys came in and they did their jobs too. So I thought everybody on our team did something to help us win a ball game, depending on how long they were there throughout the season. Some guys had more of an effect because they were there the whole year or 6 months instead of a week. But it was just really fun. We had a very group with high character. These guys just came to the ballpark to get better every single day. And the one thing was really neat, and I think I've heard a lot of people talk about this, is every time that we walked on the field, we figured we were going to win. We had that confidence that we were going to win the ball game. We didn't know how it was going to happen. We'd even fall behind 3, 4, 5 runs late in the ball game, and we just, all right, it's time to go to work. And these guys just never stopped. They never quit, and they put the pedal to the metal all the time. And it was just fun to go out and watch. It was fun to see them go out and play the game and do what they did.
Mm-hmm. And you had a little bit of a, I guess, personal competition within your family because your uncle had managed with the Rawhide. Have you kind of, or at that time with the Oaks, have you kind of, I don't know, I guess for lack of a better word, like rubbed it in his face yet? Do you want a championship, broke a drought and everything? Have you talked to him about that yet?
No, not really. He would text us whenever we'd win the first half or the second half and then text me when we won the championship. But, no, when we first got there, I saw that he had won, I think it was 82 ball games or something like that. I was like, geez, I called him. I said, man, he set the bar pretty high. But, in April, that was a lot of wins. I was like, man, that's going to be really tough to get. And then as we kept piling on some more wins and things like that, I was like, man, we have the chance to do this. But, no, I don't think it was ever anything that it was to rub in his face. You know, he's always been a mentor of mine, always someone I looked up to. And just to coach the same place he coached was pretty neat.
Mm-hmm. And I mean,
I got something to say about that. He's saying the right things and he's being humble, but the bottom line is that Sean wins baseball games, and he did it in Hillsboro for multiple years and he did it in Visalia. And Nick has his job, Travis does his thing, I do my work, but the bottom line is he puts the lineups together, he pushes the buttons, and we win baseball games. And he can be as humble as he wants to be, but he led us through the first half. We had a complete roster change pretty much. He led us through the second half and pushed the right buttons in the playoff, made the right pitching decisions, put the guys in the right spots. And we won because he has an incredible baseball mind. So he can say whatever he wants to say, but we all know that we were led by a guy who knows what he's doing and made the right decisions at the right time. So that's why he's winning baseball games. And that's why we won the championship.
I'm so happy you made this a group interview then with that kind of answer, Shane. Sure. Speaking of the team, I mean, it was amazing watching this team compete and how many games that we did win. That 13-game win streak in April and May definitely helped. And Nick, I think in like win 11 or maybe 10, I walked in and you said, I've never seen anything like this before. What about the rest of you? Had you ever seen something like that before? I guess personally?
I have.
It's pretty rare. It's pretty rare.
Go ahead, Sean.
I haven't. It was just these guys came to ballpark, and like I said earlier, it didn't matter what the score was. We knew that we were going to come back and win. I think we went to Lancaster after we tied the record, set the record, whatever it was, and we fell behind early, and these guys just kept battling back, and they just didn't want the streak to end. And it was really those guys just pushing it all the time. I don't know if we really talked about it. I think the players did, but it was just cool to see them and how much fun they did after, or how much fun they had after each win.
Mm-hmm. So like I kind of said already, this was a season with, again, a lot of wins, a lot of awesome moments. Was anyone's favorite moment not winning the championship? Like you had a different favorite moment besides that? Because if not, I'll just hop right into winning the championship. Okay, cool.
I think anytime we can promote a player, that is for me one of the, not just, oh, there's an injury or because that stuff happens or there's something. But when a player performs and cannot be ignored and gets to move on to the next level because he's forcing his way there, that's one of the best. We had a few of those this year, and that's truly one of the best moments. I think of Jason McKinley specifically, the way he came late to the team, and then he pitched in some roles that he didn't want to pitch in, and then he earned a promotion to the back end of the bullpen, and then he was pitching in high leverage situations for us. And then he literally forced the hand of the guys that make decisions because he was so good that they needed to move him. And when those things happen, Sean said it earlier, winning the championship is awesome, but developing players and watch them kind of come into their own and then get a promotion, earn a promotion and go on to the next level. I mean, that's, I think, what we're all here for, is to get guys moving on. I mean, our job's not necessarily to make big leaguers. Our job's to prepare players for the next level. And when we do that successfully, that is as good as anything.
Yeah. Anyone else have something to add on that? All right. So
Sorry to interrupt. No, he's spot on. I mean, it's what we do about, it's why we do this. We do it for these guys' careers. We've all made mistakes as players, and we're just trying to help them along their road to becoming a big league player and reach their dreams. But I think on top of winning the championship, all the champagne showers were pretty fun. I mean, those never get old. I remember we were discussing whether we should do a champagne shower after winning the second half, since we already did it, but we did. And Justin Lewis just came up and he said, "Man, this is the best night of my life. This is so much fun." And that's the reason we do these things. And that's the reason why we do it. I'll never forget. And I'm glad I didn't put any goggles on to feel the burn of that champagne. There's just nothing like that.
Yeah. Anyone else have something to add?
Yeah, I would just say, yeah, the winning the whole year was, it's something that, like, you know, you, when we are developing players, you want them to win. You need them to have that taste of winning. The more winning, the better, because then they know what that environment looks like. I know for me, I was coming up in the minor leagues with the Dodgers early on, and they cared about winning, but it was like, kind of, it was definitely development at the lower levels at that time, and which was a good thing. But the winning and knowing that, we'll get you some cereal. We're quarantined, so that's what happened. We're in a room with all the kids.
I can't.
All right. And so, but yeah. So definitely the winning. Definitely is a really good. It helps to develop players is winning. So, I mean, I think both of what they said. Okay, I'll get some cereal.
Nick, anything to add?
I think winning a championship was just kind of the icing on the season. I think the accumulation of the wins and the watching the guys get promoted, I think, even if we didn't win the championship, I would have said it would have been a pretty successful year, even if we would have lost that final series. So winning the championship was just kind of the icing on the cake for me for that year when I think about it.
And not only was it winning the championship, it was breaking a 41-year championship drought in Visalia, and in walk-off fashion, very, you know, nail-biting situation. How did this championship compare? This is for everyone. How did this championship compare to other championships in your career, whether it's playing, coaching?
Well, I'll say that I've never seen a grown man happier than Sean Roof when we won that game. And I mean that. Like, it was it made me happy watching another grown man be so happy about a win. It was fun to watch.
I know, I want to make like a gif or jip, I don't know which way, however you're supposed to pronounce it, of him just like waving Perdomo around third. We could make that go viral on TikTok or something.
I think other than watching maybe your kids be born, I don't think I've ever seen a guy happier than that.
I was just so glad we didn't have to go to game five and continue it. But I've never won a championship before. I mean, 2005, I was a regular season Big Ten championship in college in Illinois, but I had never been to the playoffs as a player. I look at some of the things that these guys did. I think Travis has won some championships. I know Nick has in Korea. Shane was a part of a World Series team with the San Francisco Giants. So I had never won a playoff game up until this year with the team. So that was nice to get that monkey off our backs. I know Shane was with Missoula, and he was the same way. He lost in 2018 as well. But I don't know where I'm going with this. But it was pretty. It
was that
fun.
Monkey was on your back, not our back. Yeah, we exactly. knew we were going to win.
There you go. Thank you for that. I know exactly where I was going with. So in 2018 in Hillsborough, Perdomo came into my office after we lost the two games in the first round, and he was crying. He goes, "I just need a ring. I need a ring. I need a ring." And to see him draw the walk, and I think he's 19 years old, to draw the walk to get on base in extra innings, and then to see Alec Thomas, one of our other top prospects in the organization, to get the big hit. I know Brecken talked about, you know, this kid's going to be special, and this is the moment's going to happen. Just to see those guys, to be in the moment, to be able to breathe, to be able to be relaxed. I mean, I remember myself being at 26, 27 years old, my last years of my career, I'd have freaked out. I mean, they would have pinch hit for me. They wouldn't let me hit at that situation. But to see those guys just that calm in the moment to do the job, and to see Perdomo score the winning run after crying in my office, and for him to be able to get that ring was pretty special.
You could barely breathe as the manager. I couldn't imagine you playing.
Shane, what does this compare with, again, I mean, World Series champs and everything. How does this compare with it?
Well, it's crazy because, like, you know, you can say, you know, your World Series or, you know, winning division championships, but, you know, I know this for me personally, and I think I can speak to some of the other guys, but, like, I had no idea how much time, effort, sweat, blood that coaches put into their craft. And, you know, I just, the amount of time Rufy spent going over lineups, the amount of time that Nick studied defenses to move a guy one step to his left or right, the amount of time Dank spent in a cage trying to get somebody right, the amount of time on a computer, I had no idea. The amount of effort and time we put in to give these kids the best opportunity to succeed, and then for it to work. I mean, it worked. I mean, I think that made this so special in our eyes as a coaching staff. And I don't feel bad because I wanted that ring, but I feel bad for coaches that don't win sometimes because I know how much effort and time they put into it. And then we were just blessed enough to come out on top. But it makes this so much more special to know that, you know, I mean, we don't stop working. And I don't know if all the players understand that we work all off season long researching players and trying to come up with things to better each player. So when all of our hard work comes together at the end of a year, holding a trophy and burning eyes with champagne and getting fitted for rings, like that is something special that players, I just don't think understand. So it was quite special to me, I know.
Any other comments on that? All right, so moving into getting ready for 2020, like you said, Shane, you guys are all working hard right now. What are you looking forward to once baseball does start? We can go around the horn. Whoever wants to hop in first.
I'll start. I think I know we all love this game, and I think at times, I don't think a lot of us ever do take it for granted. That we get a chance to put on a uniform and to put a jersey on to go out and play a kid's game. But I think one thing is throughout this time of this quarantine and the shutdown is we're never going to take a 5-hour bus ride and then having to play a doubleheader in San Jose for granted. You know, I'm never going to take a chance to during batting practice to go out and talk to a kid about his family and his kids and what's been going on in their lives, to give someone a high five after they hit a home run, or to get to call a kid into our office and mess with them a little bit and then send them up to Double A or Triple A or, you know, hopefully Monday the big leagues. I think sometimes in our eyes that we maybe do take that for granted, but from now on, those moments that we have, we'll continue to cherish them and just remember how special they really are. To hug someone after you know, winning the championship, to watch those videos, to see those guys' joys in their faces. I'm just looking forward to get back in on the diamond and just competing as a unit and watching our players, ourselves grow and playing this great game that we get the privilege to do.
Yeah, I agree with the never taking it for granted, because I told my mom, I definitely used to complain about the 11 a.m. school day games, like baseball should not be played before noon, that kind of thing. And I'm like, I will be happy to get my game notes ready for an 8 a.m. game at this point, you know?
Well, don't talk bad about kids' day games, because those are the only few of the games I ever got to play. So day games and doubleheaders, I always love. So be careful how you talk about those.
All right. Well, never again, Sean. So again, we're kind of talking about what you're looking forward to most in 2021's baseball does get started. Shane, Nick, Travis, you guys want to hop in?
Yeah, I think all of us have like an innate need to compete. Like, we like competition, and we've been doing it for so long that like having this time where we're supposed to be competing and we're not is kind of a weird, it's kind of a weird feeling. So I think that's something like we all have in us, that it kind of, when we can't do it, it kind of bothers us. Like, I guess I can't speak for everybody, but for me, that's the case. So I think for me, I'm just ready to get back to some competition again.
Shane, Travis.
Yeah, I'll speak to that too. I mean, just competition. I mean, right now I'm doing planks and abs and push-ups in my garage right now. And, not like that wouldn't have changed anyway, but competing. I mean, I just want to get outside and beat somebody up in a sporting setting, not like physical, but yeah. And then another thing too, is like, I miss my coaches' faces. I miss my players' faces. I miss having those conversations where they're really, there's stuff maybe outside of baseball, you know, that they're dealing with, and that I can maybe just listen to them. Especially as a hitting coach, there's so much stuff that these guys are going through. And so I'm looking forward to creating new relationships too, and then continuing those relationships that I had before. And so, I mean, that's one thing I'm really looking forward to. So that's about it.
Yeah. Shane?
One of the things that you know, I really didn't understand, I missed until you start talking about it, is the kind of off the cuff conversations that you aren't really ready for, or the impromptu things that come about just by a bunch of guys who have the same kind of goals and passions, and it comes together. I remember one night, all the kids left in Visalia, and we were talking about hitting, and next thing you know, we were in the cage. And there's pitching machines and tees and computers and iPads, and it's pretty much just the coaches. And we're out there, like, it kind of came out of nowhere. We're trying things out. And what if we did this? And what if this? And next thing you know, it's like 3 o'clock in the morning, and we're still out there grinding, trying to figure stuff out. Like, it's never planned. It just happens. And those are the things that just come with being a close group and with the common goal of getting guys better. And it happened on the pitching side where, you know, Derek and I would go out there and we'd start talking. Next thing you know, we're throwing each other curveballs at 1 p.m. barefoot because we're in the middle of our workouts and decide to try something out. And those conversations, I you don't really realize it at the time, but they're special when you have a group of guys that you could just do stuff like that with. And I'm looking forward to those moments when we get going again.
And hold on, don't forget, Shane went out and threw a 45-pitch bullpen, busting it up to about 90 miles an hour one day, just trying to find different release points and different things like that, way to hold the baseball to see how he can affect spin rate and the ball sinking and curveballs and things like that. So he did that too. We played his walk-up song from when he was a player. I don't know what the song was, but that was cool to see him and Mike Powell, our trainer, our strength coach Derek Somerville, and our video guy Derek Tarkonish with Tim Cisnara catching. They were out there with iPads and they hooked all kinds of different things up. So that was pretty neat too.
Yeah. Shane, what is the song?
It was by a band called Black Label Society. It's probably most people don't know what that is, so we'll just go ahead and move on to the next question.
Okay, can do. All right, this is my final planned question, but you know, there might be more that just pop up. I know all of you guys are fathers, and I'm sure you're happy to be spending a little bit more time with family right now. How is the homeschooling going? I know we talked about it a little bit before I started this interview, but who's going craziest right now? I know, Shane, you got 5 kids at one point during the week, right?
Well, my brother-in-law is a firefighter and my sister-in-law is a nurse. And so their schedules cross rarely when they need help. And we take in their 3 girls once a week, sometimes less, when their schedules cross. And so we have a pre-K, 2 kindergartners, a first grader, and a third grader. And it's awful.
It's 4 awful. Girls, 1 boy, right?
4 girls and 1 boy. And it's just, you know, for us, the setting of not being in a classroom with other kids in an organized manner is really difficult. The work itself is frustrating, but, you know, we have distractions and, you know, I'm extremely organized person. And so when they're not, and it's not going well, it gets frustrating. And, but we're doing the best we can, with what we have. And, you know, thankfully the teachers here are going above and beyond, and our school systems are, you know, providing for us and giving us the tools. And it's super hard, but we're doing the best we can. I was really hoping that they would bang May, but they just announced that they were just going to keep going. So we got about 5 weeks left and we're going to get through it.
I do have to tell you, Shane, I don't think the word organized and a pre-K student really go hand in hand.
My pre-K students are organized. We're going to have our papers out. We're going to have our colored pencils ready to go. We have our glue sticks, our scissors. We have our pencil. We have our backup pencils. We have separate erasers. We have scrap paper. We have everything we need to get the job done, to minimize distraction and wasted time. And for the most part, it works. Not always.
Okay. Good to know. Whenever I have kids, I'll get all that organized for them. All right, Travis, I know you just had a kid ask you for cereal and everything. How's that going for you?
Yeah, so I got a 3-year-old and a 6-year-old. And I mean, it's tough. It is no question, women are heroes every time. So especially the homeschool mom, man, I don't know how they do it. It's unbelievable. I have a schedule and then I'm home and then it's like I'm about to do something and then I get a kid on my lap. And so I think this whole quarantine for me, I'm learning like just to go with the flow and kind of, yeah, you can have your schedule, but really the time, like we don't get this time. And I think that, you know, I need to appreciate it. You know, it's like, at first it's like thinking, oh man, I'm going stir crazy and I need to get out and I could just go for a run real quick and come back and I'm good. But, just so like knowing when I need to get out of the house and, I need to go do that. And so, but right now, I've never had this opportunity to be at home with my kids and my family. And I think, it's slowing my whole life down. It's slowed us down. And I'm getting a chance to talk to my kids in the morning. Like I wake up with them and we get conversations and I get cool questions and I got to figure them out. And yeah, I mean, we're constantly learning. My wife will take them in the morning while I can do some other stuff. And then I'll get them on the second half of school. And I get to kind of teach them my own way. And depending on what subjects I have, like we keep it pretty fresh. Like my wife will do maybe like some spelling and sight words. And because I got a kindergartner. And then, you know, and then the other one is just constantly distracting the other one. So it's like, we have 14 different types of cereal in the house. Right. And so it's like, we got to have cereal and, they need everything. So it's absolutely incredible. And, but we're loving every minute of it, but yeah, it's yeah. God bless those women. I'll tell you that much.
Nick, Sean, anything else to add on that?
For me, you know, my son's 4, so it's a lot of, you know, activity books and things like that. But, I knew my wife was a saint, you know, let me leave for 6 months, 7 months out of the year, and having my son all day long. But it's like from 8 in the morning till 9 o'clock at night. It's Legos and hide and seek and activity books, which is awesome. And like Travis said, we've never had that opportunity. Every time I get in the car to go pick up lunch or something like that, or go get groceries, my son's like, "Are you going to Arizona, Dad?" So it breaks your heart a little bit to know that he's kind of at that age now to know that we're leaving and things like that. So to get that opportunity at 4 years old, they grow so much. To be here every single day, be able to play out in the yard. We're playing a lot more baseball. He's starting to be able to hit the ball a lot. So that's kind of our homeschooling right now is baseball and sports. But just thankful and just another realization of how special my wife is to not only be home while I'm gone, you know, pretty much raising him on her own, but to also go into work. She's a nurse. She started to go back to work again. So, you know, we're hoping that the hospital stays safe and things like that. But to not only to work and come home and to have another full-time job and not really get a chance to sit down is pretty cool. And we're thankful for it.
Yeah. Nick, anything else to add?
No, they pretty much covered. They pretty much covered the homeschooling part of this.
Mm-hmm. So that's it for me on my questions, guys. I really appreciate you taking the time to speak with me, and I hope all of your families stay safe, and I'm glad that you guys are all doing well.